Hello and welcome to the editorial analysis of the Hindu. Today we shall be discussing the editorial of the 23rd of July. So coming to the first article, the judicial presumption of non-citizenship. The context of this article is with regards to the larger process of citizenship in the state of Assam. The NRC issue in that particular context, this article has been written. Though we have discussed several articles on this, there was some analysis in this particular article which I found was what we have not discussed in the past, and that is why I have picked up this article for discussion today. So coming to the issues, first and foremost, in the context of citizenship in Assam, you should know that there are two parallel processes that are going on. One is the NRC itself, where this is a register which is being prepared, and the names of the citizens who are being included as the citizens of India, the names are what are being noted. Simultaneously, there is another process which is with regards to these foreign tribunals. Now here you should know that these foreign tribunals are being set up for discussing some cases. For instance, the police has a case that a particular person or a particular family does not have legal documents to enter India or to be a citizen in India. In that particular case, the matter is what is going to be taken up and considered by these tribunals, which are the foreign tribunals. Now, initially it was suggested that these processes are going to be parallel. That means they are not going to meet each other. They will act independently. But clearly now that is what is not happening, and they are bleeding into each other, as is being quoted in the editorial here. Many a times what is happening is that if a name is what is not in the NRC, the foreign tribunal simply declares that the person is not a citizen of India. Also, if a person has lost a case in the foreign tribunal, then the name is simply omitted in the NRC without even making an effort to cross-check the documents or re-look into the case. So this is what is creating a lot of chaos in the state of Assam, and that is what has been highlighted here. So that is what you need to know. Another important analysis, primarily the most important analysis of this editorial, is the criticism that has been offered to foreign tribunals. Now recently a case is what was there which took place in the Supreme Court, and in this particular case the Supreme Court has given a decision. This was the Abdul Quddus versus the Union of India case, and in this particular case the Supreme Court has given these foreign tribunals the status of quasi judicial bodies. And it is this judgment of the Supreme Court which has been criticized in the editorial. Now in this particular context, what has been argued here is that first and foremost, these foreign tribunals are what are formed as an executive order. They were nowhere formed as a statutory law or for that matter constitutional power. So if they are not formed by law, it is simply an executive order. How can we equate them as a quasi-judicial body? That is the first criticism. Another criticism is that if this is a quasi-judicial body, then its proceedings should be similar to courts in India. Again, this is what does not happen. The proceedings of these foreign tribunals are nowhere closer to any court proceeding. The third criticism is with regards to the qualifications of the judges here. If this was a quasi-judicial body, then some norms, some rules for qualification are what should have been there. These are also not there, and also they are flouted largely to such an extent that today even bureaucrats are part of these foreign tribunal, and this is what is a matter which has been highlighted in the editorial. Another issue is that these foreign tribunals sometimes have sweeping powers. They have powers to directly refuse the examination of any witness. In a particular case, they might simply refuse that they will not examine any witness and they will simply give the judgment. Also, there have been cases where people whose cases were what were being discussed in these foreign tribunals, they were not even served notices to appear in these foreign tribunals. So that is one criticism again that has been offered. Again, this another analysis or another metaphorical aspect that has been discussed here is with regards to the concept of highest wicket taker. Now, this the editorial is saying, as per several investigations, this is what is a joke that is being shared amongst these foreign tribunals itself. What happens is that they share a joke that which will be the foreign tribunal which will reject citizenship claims of maximum number of people, and that is what is going to be known as the highest wicket taker. Now these kind of reactions or these kind of issues are very, very critical. Why they are important is what we will analyze under the issue of impact. You have to understand that if citizenship is what is not given to a person, then what is the loss that a person is going to suffer? First and foremost, the impact is going to be drastic on that person. It is going to be severe. All the rights that we have as of now in this country are because of the fact that we are a citizen. If we are not a citizen, then who are we? What is our identity? We are probably a refugee. We will have to stay our entire lives in a refugee camp. That we will not have a passport. If we do not have a passport, where will we travel? Wherever we go, we will be an illegal immigrant. So you have to understand the severity of this particular situation. And if the matter is so severe, if this is what is the decision of these tribunals is what is going to render a person stateless, then can such kind of lacuna be there in these kind of tribunals is a question that is being raised in this editorial. Another important analysis that has been made here is with the context of the role of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court is the guardian of the fundamental rights of the citizens. It is the guardian of the human rights in our country. So if the Supreme Court itself is going to act in such a manner where it is giving legitimacy to these kind of tribunals which are not following the rule of law, then in that case, where will the citizens go is what is being again highlighted in the editorial. So that is what is the entire analysis of this particular editorial. I have discussed several editorials on NRC, but the criticism to foreign tribunals was what was new to the, or in particular to this particular editorial only, and that is why this is important. You might have a scope to discuss about NRC, criticize the entire process, criticize foreign tribunals, and that is where this editorial will be of help to you. So that's about this particular article. Coming to the next, a misleading presentation of a labor program. Now the context here is with regards to the economic survey, a chapter in the economic survey. This chapter is discussing about MNREGA, that is the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, in the context of Aadhaar. Now basically this editorial is highlighting that this economic survey chapter is what is highly affiliated to a particular study that was conducted by the ISV Institute of India. So in this particular context, this editorial is advocating that this Indian School of Business Working Report had been also been criticized, it had also been rebutted, but the economic survey has simply picked up only one aspect of this particular report and made it a chapter in the economic survey. So in this context, this editorial is criticizing the economic survey and in particular this particular chapter. Now coming to the criticism and the issues, first and foremost in the issue is with regards to the Aadhaar itself. Now basically the editorial is highlighting the chapter that has been talked about in the economic survey. The chapter in question here is the transformational impact that Aadhaar has had on MNREGA. And in the economic survey, all hunky-dory things and all positive impacts of Aadhaar are what have been talked about, that how Aadhaar and linking of Aadhaar with the MNREGA and the usage of Aadhaar for distribution of wages is what has had a very, very positive impact on MNREGA, and rather it has reformed the entire structure. But this the editorial is saying is only half truth, and rather a lot of facts are what have been ignored. The second analysis that has been offered is with regards to wages. Now it is in this context that Aadhaar has been appreciated here, but the editorial is saying that Aadhaar is simply a pipeline to make the payments. If Aadhaar is what is doing well, then in that case it does not mean the wages have gone high. There are several issues when it comes to the wages of MNREGA, and these issues are vis-a-vis the inadequate financial allocation. If finances are only not adequate, what can Aadhaar do? So that is one problem that is still faced in the context of MNREGA wages. Another issue is with regards to the pending liabilities. That is one issue which has been time and again criticized and time and again highlighted against MNREGA, that the wages are what are not given on time, rather there is a delay and the lag is one issue vis-a-vis the MNREGA wages, and that again is what Aadhaar has nothing to do with. Another issue is with regards to the low wages. Now in several of India's states, many of Indian states have wages approximately 40% lower than what has been recommended as by the Ministry of Labour as the national minimum wages. So many a times this is another challenge that is emerging, and that these are what the editorial should have discussed in the cost in the context of NREGA rather than blatantly only appreciating Aadhaar. So that is what has been highlighted here. Another analysis that has been made here is that in the economic survey, in this chapter in the economic survey, the era before 2015 is what is called as the pre-DBT era, direct benefit transfer era. This is primarily to highlight that only after 2015, when the Aadhaar Act is what came and linking with Aadhaar was what was done, that direct benefit transfer is actually what took place. This is again being objected in the editorial. The editorial is highlighting that the electronic fund management system is what was in place since the year 2011 itself, and so calling the era between 2015 as a pre-DBT era is not correct. Rather, in the form of direct benefit transfer, this was what was being done since long. So that is what has been highlighted here. Another analysis is with regards to the payments delay. Now here what has been said in the editorial, rather for that matter the economic survey chapter, is that a lot of the delay in these payments is what has been reduced because of Aadhaar. Now for this an explanation is what has been offered. Now here you have to understand that the wage payment system in the context of NREGA is what is divided into two stages, the stage 1 and the stage 2. What happens in the stage 1 is that the block level office, they generate an electronic fund transfer order. Once they are convinced that work is what has been done, they generate an EFTO, that is the electronic fund transfer order, and this is what goes to the central government. Now till this particular point of time, this there is no role of Aadhaar here. Because clearly this is what is a bureaucratic work. The role of Aadhaar comes in the second phase. Once this demand is what has been sent by the block level office to the central government, the central government approves it, and then fund transfer is what takes place through Aadhaar. So what the editorial is discussing is that whatever is the improvement is what has taken place in stage 1, and Aadhaar has no role to play here. The stage 2 delays are what are still continuing, and they are time and again criticized even today. So how is it that the economic survey is claiming that this decrease in the time span or this decrease in the payment delay is what has taken place because of Aadhaar? This is what is rebutted and refuted in the editorial. Another analysis is with regards to the drought affected area. Now the editorial here is saying that the economic survey in its chapter has said that a lot has been done in the context of MGNREGA's impact on drought affected area. A lot has been done in the context of payments to those people who are affected by drought. But here clearly the economic survey has ignored the Supreme Court judgments that were given in this context. After the year 2015, Supreme Court has given many judgments in the context of how MGNREGA has to be used for drought affected areas, how there should be no delay in the payments to people in drought affected areas. And it was primarily because of these judgments that some progress was what was done, rather than because of Aadhaar. So that is one analysis. Another analysis that has been offered, which is important, is with regards to the government cherry picking its data. What is happening is that the government is selectively choosing from data and trying to show a hunky-dory picture or a golden picture rather than showing the weaknesses in truth. So that is what has been criticized in the editorial. This point is relevant for us because in the past also criticism has come against the government as to its improper use of data and hiding some data from the masses. And in this particular context, this is going to be a good example. So that is the entire analysis of the article. Relevance is whenever you have to analyze MGNREGA. Otherwise, direct question on criticizing the economic survey chapter, I doubt will come. But yes, a question can come as to the benefits of Aadhaar for MGNREGA. So you have to show some benefits. This article is an altogether negative article. It is completely criticizing, which is okay. It is acceptable for this article being in the newspaper, but this is not going to be acceptable in your answer in the mains paper. You have to show some positive aspects from this economic survey chapter as well. But yes, you must also talk about the negatives, which have been adequately provided in this editorial. So that is how you have to use this particular article. Coming to the next article, Soaring to the Moon. The context here is with regards to the Chandrayaan 2, which has successfully been launched by the ISRO. It is a very, very proud moment for us. Just a few days back, we had discussed that how the launching was what was delayed or it was postponed in the past. So in that particular context, this editorial becomes important. This mission itself is what is important. I have picked up all the key ideas and the key words from this particular editorial, and this will be sufficient for you to frame an answer if a question does come in this context. First and foremost, you need to know some history. You need to know about the Chandrayaan 1. The Chandrayaan 1 was what was launched in the year 2008, and this was what was the first ever India's lunar probe. After the Chandrayaan 1, after almost 10 years, it is now the Chandrayaan 2 is what has been launched. That is what you need to know. Another important analysis vis-a-vis the Chandrayaan 2 is that for the first time ever in the world, the south polar region of the moon is what is going to be explored, and this is what is going to be done by the Chandrayaan 2. In the past, only the equatorial part of the moon is what has been always explored. So this is a newer development which the world is looking up to. Another analysis is with regards to the GSLV Mark 3. Now this is what is been first time made indigenously in India. Previously, I had also discussed that it is with the GSLV that India has always had glitches and issues. The PSLV is the workhorse of India, but GSLV was something that was giving trouble to the scientists. So now India has even achieved its might in the GSLV, and it is what has successfully launched the Chandrayaan 2. This has been sent satellites weighing up to approximately 4 tons is what has been highlighted in the editorial. So try and remember these facts vis-a-vis these particular technical aspect. Another thing that you need to know here is with regards to the parts of this particular mission. Now here the Chandrayaan 2 basically comprises of a lander. The lander is what is known as Vikram. So this is what you should know. This will be that part of this particular mission which will land on the moon, and there will be a rover. The rover is what is known as Pragyan. So you should know these names. The rover is going to rotate around, and the lander is actually going to reach and land on the moon. So that is what is important. Also in the context of landing, what you should know know is that this is what is going to follow soft landing. This is a newer achievement for India. In the past, India has not been able to efficiently ensure soft landing. Why soft landing is important? So that the lander is what is not disturbed. There is no fault that is created in the lander. This is what has required an efficient braking system. So this is what India has now achieved, and that is what is a major achievement. Also, the Chandrayaan 2 will be seeking for or doing research on the availability of water on moon, the possibility of water on moon. Also, what is important here is that terrain mapping is what is going to be done here. A 3D map is going to be prepared. It has more sophisticated cameras compared to Chandrayaan 1, so that is one achievement. It will also test for lunar seismicity. It will check the temperature gradient as well as the thermal conductivity of the moon's surface. So all of this is what is the prospect or the mission of the Chandrayaan 2. So that is what you should know about. This is a landmark moment for India. Even if you don't have a direct question on Chandrayaan 2, there will be ample scope for you to discuss about ISRO, to discuss about India's space program, and that is where this is what is going to come of help to you. So that is about this particular article. Coming to the next article, what's next? In my opinion, this is not an important article, but still I have picked it up for 2 points. Basically, this is in the context of the National Medical Commission bill. If you are following my discussions for long, you will know that in the past I have discussed so much about the NMC bill, but eventually what happens is that the bill is what is not, until it becomes an act, it is not of much relevance. For instance, the previous NMC bill was what was defeated primarily because of the dissolution of the Lok Sabha. So it is the new NMC bill which is now in news, and UPSC has a tendency that it doesn't ask about a bill because a lot is subject to change and all of that is the issue. But still, there are 2 points that we can and we at least should have some knowledge about. First and foremost here that has been talked about is the next. This is the national exit test. This bill is proposing that once MBBS degree is what is done by the students, all over India there should be one common test. That should be the next. Instead of the final year exams of the MBBS course, they should be the students should take a test which is the next test. And after this, all the students will then become eligible to practice medicine in the country. And even based on this particular test, PG, post-graduation seats will be given to the students. So this is one proposal. Also, if you remember in the previous NMC bill, there is a proposal of a bridge course where all the Ayush practitioners could take this bridge course and then practice allopathy. This idea is what has now been dropped in the second bill. So that is the only two developments which I could extract from this particular editorial. Obviously, of not much use and not much relevance to us. So that's what this particular article. Coming to the next, smoking e-cigarettes is more injurious to health. Indeed, an important one. Now the context here is, with regards to our proposal, remember this is only a proposal and this is not something that has happened as of now. There is a proposal to ban e-cigarettes in India as well as something called ENDS. Now what is this ENDS? These are electronic nicotine delivery systems. So this is what you should know in the context of ENDS. Anything that is an electronic device which is delivering nicotine is what is under this category of ENDS. This includes some electronic hookahs also. There are several other things that are being used for the intake of nicotine. So this is the context here is that there is a proposed ban. So this is what the editorial is discussing about. Now coming to the issues, first issue here that is important here is, with regards to several attempts to bring about a ban on these e-cigarettes, in the past an advisory was what was issued by the health ministry just last year, and after this almost 15 states banned the usage of e-cigarettes within their territory. These states are what have been talked about here. These include Karnataka, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Jammu, Kashmir, Mizoram. All of these states have banned the usage of e-cigarettes. Another analysis that is important here is, with regards to the popularity of these e-cigarettes amongst the youth, this is one of the major concerns for the country. Now here you should know that it is the youth that is most vulnerable. Youth is more attracted to these kind of things just because of a lack of judgment and the vulnerable age. So what is important is that they should have been prevented. Rather, what has happened is that these electronic devices have attracted the youth and thus increased this epidemic amongst the youth. So that is what is one criticism against these e-cigarettes as well as these ENDS. So that is what has been discussed in this particular aspect of the editorial. Another important issue that has been discussed here is with regards to the myths that are associated. Now basically you should know that it is a clear message as of now that conventional cigarettes and conventional methods of consuming nicotine have negative impacts. This is what is well proven. And if the youth, for instance, even in this particular example, if the youth were to choose between conventional methods, they would have probably not chosen these cigarettes. But because this was an unconventional method, they got attracted towards it. So this is the myth that has been created. The myth is that e-cigarettes are what are less risky. This is a myth. That is clearly not the case. There are no safer alternatives to the conventional methods. Another myth that is being created by the companies here is that they say that e-cigarettes are what can be smoked anywhere, anytime, which clearly shows that they can flout the rules where smoking is what is prohibited in public places. So it is being advertised by these companies that e-cigarettes are what can be consumed anywhere. So that is what is again being criticized, and that is what is not the case here. So this is one issue that has been highlighted in the editorial, that these myths are being created, and clearly to bust these myths, the government should take an effort. The government should focus on this, and a ban on these is what is indeed important. Another analysis is with regards to nicotine consumption or nicotine addiction becoming an epidemic in India, especially with the youth being affected. And for those people who would have quit cigarettes, instead of quitting cigarettes, they adopt for the e-cigarettes. So this is what is becoming a pan-India phenomenon. It is becoming an epidemic. There are dual users also in India today who are using both conventional as well as e-cigarettes also. So in this particular context, in that context of the longer health interest of the citizens of India, this is what is not something that is advisable, and that is what has been discussed in the editorial. So indeed the editorial is important, the idea is important. You will have to use this in your answers whenever you are discussing any health issue. Also, a direct question is also what you can expect here. So that is how the editorial is relevant, and that is how you have to use it. So that's about this particular article. These are the articles for today. We have discussed 5 articles. These were the only articles that I found relevant. So with this, we finish our discussion, and thank you all for watching the video.